स्वादयन्निह सर्वेषां त्रय्यन्तार्थं सुदुर्ग्रहं स्तोत्रयामास योगीन्द्रः तं वन्दे यामुनाह्वयम् नमो नमो यामुनाय यामुनाय नमो नमः नमो नमो यामुनाय यामुनाय नमो नमः यत्पदाम्भोरुहध्यान विध्वस्ताशेषकल्मषः वस्तुतामुपयातोऽहम् यामुनेयम् नमामि तम्
स्वधर्मज्ञानवैराग्य साध्यभक्त्येकगोचरः नारायणः परम् ब्रह्म गीताशास्त्रे समीरितः
श्रीमान् वेङ्कटनाथार्यः कवितार्किककेसरी वेदान्ताचार्यवर्यो मे सन्निधत्ताम् सदा हृदि
एकादशे स्वयाथात्म्य साक्षात्कारावलोकनम् साक्षात्कार अवलोकनम् दत्तमुक्तम् विधिप्राप्त्योः भक्ति भक्ति एका उपायता तथा
इन द 11th चैप्टर द आई विच कैन सी ए डायरेक्ट विजन ऑफ हिम एज ही इज इन हिमसेल्फ इज गिवन टू अर्जुन एंड अकॉर्डिंगली इट इज टॉट दैट द ओनली मीन्स ऑफ नोइंग एंड अटेनिंग हिम इज डिवोशन
एकादशे इन द 11th चैप्टर beautifully given as chapter in the brackets so that the Sanskrit word is not available. Ekadashe Adhyaye. So because it's very concise in nature, the shloka is very brief and to the point also, there are only 8 syllables possible in a quarter. Therefore, Ekadashe in the 11th, Swayathatmya. So Swayathatmya is the real form. Here it is given as direct vision, but meaning the real form. Yathatmya is the real form, one's own real form, and therefore his own real form. It is Lord's real form, the Supreme Soul's real form. Then Sakshatkara Avalokanam. Almost both are synonymous. Sakshatkaram is realization, Avalokanam is seeing. Again, Sakshatkara. The word is from the word akshi. Akshi means eye, meaning avalokanam, vision. So sakshatkara is our ability to see the Lord in flesh and blood. So sakshatkara. And that means again realization of his original form. Yathatme sakshatkara. Then avalokanam is seeing. Now, this has been given to Arjuna. It is there in translation. So dattam is given. And uktam, it is said. It is said to Arjuna. And what is very important is, the first point in the 11th chapter is how to see the Lord, how to have the vision of the Lord in the true form. That is the first aspect. The second aspect is how to know him and how to reach him. So vidhi meaning knowing him. Vidhi meaning knowing him. From the root vidhi to know, vidya knowledge, vidya wisdom. And vidhi here refers to two shades of meaning are there. Oh, number one, shabda. Shabda meaning how do you understand God? Through scriptures. So scriptural knowledge is necessary. Vidhi meaning vidhi to know again. Vidhi the dhatu, the root, R-O-O-T. Meaning to know. Knowledge is contained in scriptures. The basic or fundamental book which you must understand is scripture. Therefore that is what we call shastra. Shastra. Or science. or we can say spiritual science. So vidhi is shabda. It also means grammar. So unless you understand the grammar of the Lord, the grammar of the Lord in the sense, the grammar of the words in the scriptures which describe the Lord. So vidhi meaning the grammar also, shabda. So shabda means normally of course four meanings are there, that is different. So here shabda means grammar. Vidhi then praptyoho. Now there are two things to achieve. Number one, we must understand him. Number two, we must reach him. Then how do we reach him? How do we understand him? That is namely bhakti eka upayata. Bhakti eka upayata. Now please remember the essence of the Vaishnava Sampradaya is Lord himself is the upaya. Lord himself is the means. Lord himself is the strategy through which we can understand him and we can reach him. And again, it is also implied that he blesses us with the vision, Sakshatkar Avalokanam. He blesses us with wisdom, vidhi. Then praptyoho, he gives the direction to reach him. So all this, but here it is given as bhakti eka upayata. Bhakti, the devotion, is the only means to attain him, reach him. The bhakti is the only means to understand him. All these are all there. Of course, we already saw that, again I remind ourselves that bhakti, karma, jnana, bhakti are three in one. And then we understand because of our deep interest that we must realize him and we must reach him, we must understand him and we must see him. That is all. So here bhakti is understood as upayata. Of course, there are two words in shastras which say, all of you are already familiar with, I think, namely sadhyopaya and siddhopaya. There are two types of upaya. Upaya means. So there are what you call siddhopaya is Lord. What I mean by siddhopaya, according to my understanding, is he is ready at hand. He is ready at hand. So he is available. Siddhopaya. As a means, he is available. He does not make himself obscure. He doesn't hide himself. So he is available frankly, openly. He is open. We can understand him. Number two, that is Siddhopaya. I also attach a meaning to Siddhopaya. He is a successful means. There is no failure on the part of Lord to make us understand. He always succeeds. And therefore, Siddha gives you success also. There is no doubt that you will get success if you approach through him. Again, that is what we feel one with him in Sattvika Tyaga. He is doing everything. That is one thing. So now the bhakti is called Sadhyopaya. Again, there is a positive aspect both in Sadhyopaya and Siddhopaya, meaning that we will have never any failure. We will have never any lacuna, no difficulty in understanding him. Therefore, Sadhyopaya is, Sadhyam is achievable. So bhakti can achieve what we want, namely a supra vision, a divine vision of the Lord Sriman Narayana, and two other things, namely you can understand him, realize him, and then thirdly you can reach him. Now these three are also synonymous. That meaning, when you see him, you reached him. When you are able to see him, you have already reached him. When you see him, you have already understood him. That means all three are almost synonymous. It is not a question of seeing him, then understanding him, or understanding him and then seeing him, and then finally reaching him. All are put into one cluster. So just as you see him, because you understand him, you see him. Because you reach him, therefore you are seeing him. So I'm not confusing. So the last word on the bhakti is sadhyopaya. Sadhyopaya, it is the means. Bhakti, devotion, is the means to achieve all these three. All the three are in one cluster, I mean, one group. And then sadhyopaya meaning, it is very much possible. It is not impossible at all. So that through bhakti, through devotion, we can have divine vision, at the same time understanding, and at the same time proximity, the nearness with him. That is the essence of this 11th chapter. All these three are explained here. Sakshatkar avalokanam, number one. Don't put it as separately. Sakshatkar avalokanam. It is only single compound word in Sanskrit also. The beauty in explanation is sakshatkarascha etat avalokananche sakshatkar avalokanam. So please remember that both are one and the same. Again, of course, the words in English are different. Realization, sakshatkara realization. In fact, because you are a jivatma, in this world, in Leela Vibhuti, the individual soul has got lot of limitation. But as a muktatma, released soul, in Vaikuntha, you don't have any restrictions. And therefore, the sakshatkara is very easy. Because you are a released soul, you are able to look at him, and then you are able to realize him. Therefore, you are able to see him. Now, seeing him also involves not only just by eyes of the muktatma, because the sense organs in muktatma will work anything, anytime. In any way, Upanishad says, you can see with your ears, you can hear with your eyes, and then so on. So you can exchange the actions, sense organs' actions to each other, and any sense organ can do any of these five actions. And therefore, release the soul. And therefore, there is no question of failure at all. Always successful. We are always successful. And again, that's what I want to say. Sakshatkara avalokanam is only one set. So that is the first point in the 11th chapter. The second point is again, vidhi praptyoho. Vidhi praptyoho, bhakti upayata. How does the devotion act as the means to understand him and reach him? Again, though the Sanskrit word says, in dvivachanam, that is dual, vidhi praptyoho, knowing him and understanding him, understanding him and teaching him are different. It is not so. It is also said, according to Shastras, as soon as you get the wisdom, you are into moksha. That's all. Jnanan moksha. Jnanan moksha. As soon as the very moment that you get the wisdom, the same moment you are in beatitude, you are in salvation. And therefore, there is no question of getting jnana for some time and then realizing it later, after some time. There is no time gap at all. There is no time gap. So that's why, but of course, here the 11th chapter tells us how bhakti can act as means to understand him and reach him. So you can split it into four actions, one, two, three, four, five also. or simply one. So sakshatkar avaloganam, vidhi, prapti, all these are possible by bhakti. Again I repeat, having a divine vision, that is by one word, sakshatkar avalokanam, having the divine vision plus understanding plus reaching, all these three are achieved by, namely sadhyopaya, called sadhyopaya, namely bhakti devotion. Therefore, that's very easy, but the translation is also very simple to understand. But I have not come across the usage, though I underwent the Gita Sangraha earlier. I think memory failed me.
Which particular usage?
The vidhi.
Oh, that vidhi. Okay.
Yeah.
So, should we look at the commentary?
Yeah. Okay. So here he is explaining in a different way. 68. So sakshatkara hetu bhutam avaloka. We use the word English also, look it up. So that is avaloka, look it up. When you look it up, it becomes the reason for realization. Sakshatkara is the result. Avalokanam is seeing. Now again, avalokanam will involve your action, karma yoga. By your ordinary, what we call mamsa chakshu, I always say, the physical eyes, avalokanam. So how do you go about avalokanam is, by doing all the duties enjoined in our human life, plus reading of the books, that is involved in avalokanam. Avalokanam will have deep involvement in doing all the duties and trying to find the wisdom in our duties. And to acquire wisdom, we go to a preceptor and read books. That is avalokanam. So that avalokanam will lead to sakshatkara. Therefore, in Sanskrit it is very beautiful, because sakshatkara also can be a hetu to avalokanam. The realization is also a reason for seeing him. But seeing him is a reason for sakshatkara. So that's why sakshatkar avalokanam is a single set. Then avalokyate anena iti avalokanam iha. And this is also very important. So just a second. Please remember, I'm saying something practical. We worship at home. That is normal. If you don't worship at home, that is not correct. We must worship at home. We must worship exactly the saligramam, the idol, whatever we have at home. That is more important than any other deity anywhere else. I would rather say, it is more important than your antaryami, the soul inside your heart. Because it is bahya, it is what is outside your body. You have a puja room, you have an almera where you keep your vigrahas, saligramas and so on, or at least a photo. So anything, it's what you call, you get Dwaraka Shila, the stone from the Dwaraka. Again, I mean, what I mean, to, of course, is the principle, basic principle, all of you know understand is everything is God. Everything is God. But we choose something special. So Saligrama is specially chosen from Nepal, Kentucky River Bank. It's actually a fossilized insect nest. You can say nest of the insect. The what you call the house of the insect, which is fossilized. And therefore, we have different figures there. Narasimha, Chakra Talwar, Chakra, the Sudarshanam, and many, many others. There are some ways to identify the Saligrama. There are ways of proving that it is a good Saligrama, and so on. So you keep it in mind that the deity at home, or rather our titular deity, Kula Deva, is more important than any other deity, though the deity is the same, the God is same, with different names in different places. Number two, we go to the temple. Number one, we worship at home. Number two, we go to the temple. Now, why do we go to the temple? In order to remind ourselves that there is God. And we should never forget the presence of God everywhere. That is why we are reminded by going to the temple. Archavatara is meant for making us continuously remember. That is the purpose which, not for, I think, many people, many of us, including me, we take it as a picnic. We take it as an outing. Because it is very boring to stay at home for a long time, we want to have some outing. So we want to eat outside, we want to travel, we want to see people, and we want to see the places. We say sightseeing. We go for sightseeing. The temple also happens to be a sightseeing structure. So it is not the avalokanam here. So here, avalokanam, as you look at the word, grammar of the word, you look down. Ava means down. You look down meaning, from the face you look down at your heart. You bend your face and look at your heart. And you must also feel that you are down. That meaning you are nothing before the Lord. Nothing before the Lord. You are the slave of the Lord. And so on, that is avalokanam. Whereas if you are treating the God in high esteem, that you look up. Whenever we say God is there in Vaikuntha, we point out our hand up and say sky. We point out to the sky above. And then we say there is heaven, there is Vaikuntha, there is Kailash, and so on, so many other words. All worlds, upper worlds are there. So that means the high thought, that is the thought of a high person, thought of the highest person. One thing. So avalokanam. While you concentrate on your home deity, and you concentrate on the temple deity, Archavatara, and then you respect your antaryami. Last comes, the fourth will be antaryami, and then comes archa. When you go to a temple, you know earlier that it is, the figure is lying down or standing or sitting. Nindra Thirukolam, Amartha Thirukolam, and Shayana Thirukolam. So these are all three postures of the Lord we have. Sometimes dancing Gopala Krishna also. Playing flute in the garden. So many other forms. So when you go to a temple, you prepare yourself that you will be seeing only a particular type of figure, the divine figure. That is also there. So all these are an avalokanam involved, all your experience, direct experience, the direct experience which you cannot divulge to anyone else. You cannot reveal to anyone else. That is the inner experience is called avalokanam. I won't confine the avalokanam by what, by just saying seeing with the eyes, seeing with your heart, and keeping the Lord in the heart continuously without any interruption, without any deviation, distraction, and form. So that is avalokanam. Sakshatkar avalokanam. So coming to the commentary again. Yes. So avalokyate anena iti avalokanam iha divyam. Can you make it smaller fonts?
I can make it smaller, but for the video, it's important for it to be big for the video.
Okay. I can see it in English one part. So divyam chakshu, right? So avalokyate anena iti avalokanam iha divyam chakshu. Now it's very clearly given here, as I said to you. I didn't say it as divine. The other things I said. So divyam chakshu, you see with the third eye. You see with the third eye. You experience with the subconscious mind. So that is avalokyate anena. Anena meaning by the jivatma, by the individual soul, avalokyate. Lord is being seen. That is avalokana. And I wanted to tell you this, which all of you definitely may know. Why it is definitely may know is, when you go to a temple, and of course it is a small distance outside your home. Say for example, even the deity at home, when I say this, I'm able to realize what I'm not doing perfectly. Namely, I'm in a room here, hall. The room where the sannidhi of the Lord is there is different. The room is different. So when I come from this room to that room, there must be some inspiration. The Lord is expecting me to come to Him. That's what I want to say. Lord expects me. Lord is waiting for me to come there. It is not I wait for Him to come there. He waits for me. And then when He waits for me, what I mean to say is, are you ready to perform Tiruvaradhanam? He seems to say. Did you take bath? That's physically what I want to. So are you wearing the marks on the forehead? Will you be offering to me the food, because it is Dwadashi Parana day, where the Dwadashi Nadika, the time of Dwadashi is very, very near, or is about to close. So these are all certain things that, so when He expects me, so you take the example, we go to the temple. When we go to the temple, Vedanta Swami, Vedanta Deshaya, in his Bhagavad Dhyana Sopanam says, He has opened His eyes so widely. So we call it Vispara Chakshu. You know, with the surprise, with the expectation, with the longing, and so on. He expects you to arrive quick, soon into the sanctum sanctum. Just as He expected Tirupanadvar to come to Him. So here, so what does He say is, His eyes are welcoming eyes. He knows that we are coming to the temple with a different purpose. What different purpose? Except the purpose of seeing Him. So He says, Sa abhipraya, the opinion, our opinion is different from His opinion. Sa abhipraya. So when He understands our idea, our aim to visit the temple, then he is laughing at us. He is smiling at us. Sa abhipraya smita. Smita is smiling. Vikasitam. The flower-like eyes are opening. The bud-like eyes are opening and becomes a flower, blossoms into a flower. because he is smiling, he understands that we are not coming to the temple with a purpose which he thinks is right, with the right purpose. Sabhipraya vidavikasitam charu bimbagaroshtam. His lips are throbbing, just like what we call the bimba fruit. The bimba fruit is called in Tamil kovakkai, and when it becomes fruit, it is crimson in color, very beautiful in color. And they normally, the poets in Sanskrit will always compare any lip with either man's lip or woman's lip with the bimba fruit. And charu is beautiful. Both the upper lip and the lower lip are beautiful. Charu bimba dharottam. I want you to enjoy the figure. That is what you call avalokanam. That is what we call avalokanam. Now, I will give you some immediate example. You go to a Rama temple in Tillai Valaham. It's a place called Tillai Valaham. And also, Vadu. There are one more place near in the Tanjavur Bell, near Trichy, where when you see the lip of the Lord, it sports a smile. The I would call it first lifeless figure. A lifeless figure, how can it give a living smile, a live smile? That is, of course, that I always base it upon the sculptor's bhakti, the devotion of the sculptor who made it, and therefore it smiles. You can have the vision very easy. So what I mean is that charu bimbadarottam. Then the next second purpose for which we go to the temple is dukkha paya. We are facing dangers like corona. Dukkham as well, suffering. Dukkha paya. Therefore we love God. Pranayini jane. We are all loving people. We love God because we have some suffering. We want help. We want some friendship. We want to alleviate our suffering, reduce our suffering. Therefore, we have approached the Lord for help. Dukkha paya pranayini jane. Now, this is very, very, very important. When you are at a long distance, when you are in Hawaii, the Sri Ranganatha expects you to come here. Dura dattabhimukhyam. We say Ranganatha is facing the south. Hawaii is not, Hawaii is not on the south, southern direction, then he looks at you. That is what I mean today, avalokana. Dura dattabhimukhyam. He gives a look. Dattabhimukhyam. Abhimukhyam is a welcoming look. He expects you to arrive. Dura datta abhimukhyam. How is the face? Kantam. It is like a magnet. We say in Tamil also the word kantam. Not kantam, in kantam. But he is kanta. He is the beloved. He is the kansat. And we are the wives. Kantam, vaktram. Vaktram is face. Now you understand the avalokanam. Kanaka tilaka alankritam. His forehead has got a beautiful gold tilak, gold mark. Kanaka tilaka alankritam. Kantam vaktram kanaka tilaka alankritam. Whose face? Rangabhartuhu. Ranganatha. Then, as soon as you see this, what happened? Swantam, our mind. Gadham, deeply. Swantam gadham mama, my heart is attracted towards him. You don't say all by all, everybody's heart, because you have devotion. You say swantam gadham mama vilagati. Vilagati meaning gets attached and cannot be separated. As soon as you go and see the Lord, then you don't want to come back. We don't want to stop seeing. Pantham gadam vilagati swagato daranetram swagata. He welcomes swagata. Udaranetram. His eyes are broad now. Now already broad, but now broader. The eyes are broader. This avalokanam is again, as we say in Sattvika Tyaga, the action which is performed by him, not by us. We don't look at him. He looks at us. Please remember, anena atmana kartra, by this individual soul, he looks at the individual. He doesn't have the, we are not looking at the Supreme Soul. So he, what that means, he has expectations. And therefore, the Lord's name, special name is Mukundaha. Mukundaha. It's a very beautiful, just a three-lettered word, three syllables. Mukundaha. Most of the names are very short. In Sahasranam, you'll find not very big words. Very rarely you see big words. Long words. Here, Mukundaha, the beauty is Mukham. The two syllable word Mukham, say, is again abbreviated into one letter, one syllable, Mu. So Mukham. Then Kundam means jasmine. Jasmine flower is called Kundam. Kundam Pushpam is called jasmine flower. So Mukundaha meaning his face blossoms like a jasmine flower when bhaktas approach, when devotees approach. That is the meaning of the word Mukunda. Mukham kundam iva vikasati yada bhaktaha agacham. When the devotees in throng the temple, when the devotees throng the temple, he is very happy and his face blossoms like a jasmine flower. So why is it this? This is what we call avalokanam. Even in Tirupati, I would say, because that is Jarigandi is the Telugu word used for to push you out. There are so many people to push you out. But there is one lot to see, ready to see. So as soon as you go into the temple, a few split seconds, not even few seconds, you are pulled out. Whereas, who is seeing you? The Lord is seeing you. Not you. You are not able to see the Lord from the head to foot. Tirupan Alvar explained in Amalanadi Piran the entire description, Kappappi description. But we are not able to sit there, stand there and look at the Lord. We are not allowed to do that. But who is allowed to do it? The Lord looks at us. So, Sakshatkara Avalokanam. So, Sakshatkara is the direct perception. Sakshatkara is direct perception. Avalokanam is seeing. The same word, same meaning. Sakshatkara Avalokanam. Now we go to the next line in the comment. Vidipraptyoho. Again, Vidipraptoho it is there. Again, there is something, you cannot say Praptoho. Prapti, okay, Prapti, Harihi, Harehe, Harioho. No. Again, wrong. Vidipraptyoho, as it is in your Gita Tasangara verse stanza, you must have Praptyoho, not Praptoho. Vidipraptyoho. Right. Good. So vidipraptyoho iti darshanasya api upalakshanam. So it is given very clearly here. So darshanam is avalokanam. Darshanam is equal to, congruently similar to avalokanam. Three lines, horizontal lines. Equal to has got two lines, two horizontal lines. Three lines. In mathematics we use congruently similar. So darshanam is congruently similar to avalokanam. Therefore, darshanasya, avalokanasya api, upalakshanam. Upalakshanam is the what we call the ancillary definition. The ancillary definition, meaning division number one, B. Division number A is avalokanam with divyam chakshu, so with the divine vision, and vidipraptyoho is darshanasya upalakshanam, meaning vidhi is understanding him as we know already just now. Praptyoho is reaching him. So understanding him, reaching him is both are parts of darshanam, having a vision. And having a vision with the divine eyes, divyam chakshu. That's what we saw in Krishna Avatara. He was trying to bless people, Arjuna, Karna, Dhritarashtra, and so on, with his universal form, Vishwarupam. And he gave divyam chakshu. He gave divine vision to Dhritarashtra, though he was physically blind in this world, in the mortal form. He was given the divyam chakshu. But in spite of being given divyam chakshu, he did not want to see. That was his bad luck. Tathahi giyate. Tathahi. Tathahi, normally, tatha is simple meaning is so, tatha so. He indeed. Tathahi cannot be together. Tatha and he will be separate. Why I said it is, once you know some word meaning, ahi will be snake. Ahi meaning snake. Adishesha is ahihi. Vasuki is ahihi. Taksha is ahihi. Snake. Sarpaha. Nagaha. So many words are there. So tata plus hi. Yes. Giyate. Now it is sung here. Bhagavad Gita should be sung. As always, I always say, Tirupavai must be sung. Tirupavai, Tati Tirupavai of Andal, Goda, Devi, must be sung. Vayinal Padi. You cannot read it. You should not read a song. Even here, we must follow Govindacharya's one. Singing in different ways, the same verse, and singing differently, the different verses. So bhaktya tu ananyaya, so you sing it with devotion. What kind of devotion? Unalloyed, unmixed up, uncontaminated devotion. Ananyaya shakyaha aham. This is of course Bhagavad Gita 11th chapter 54th verse. So aham evam vidhihi, aham evam, sorry, both letters da is not, is to be replaced by Alpa Prana, aham evam viditaha Arjuna. Bhaktya to ananya shakyaha, aham evam vidorjana, that's all. Not two double, no dha repeated. Evam vidorjana. Right. That's right. Okay. Evam vidorjana. Jnatum drashtuncha tattvena praveshtuncha parantara. The 54th verse of the 11th chapter tells us it is possible only through, it is possible, shakyaha possible, to but ananyaya bhaktya, with a concentrated devotion, with a devotion not dissipated, undissipated devotion to any other deity. So bhaktya to ananyaya shakyaha, aham, I, evam vidaha Arjuna. Evam vidaha meaning in this type. The whole chapter gives us the method of devotion, how Lord can be approached. So the second line tells you what to do about the Lord. Jnatum drashtum. This is what we, Vidhi in the Gita Tasangraha, then avalokanam for drashtum. Sakshatkara avalokanam is equivalent to drashtum. Drashtum to see, to have a look. Again by divine vision. Jnatum is vidhi, to understand him. Tatvena, by the principle. Again, tatvena can give you two sides of meaning, two angles of meaning. Number one, tattvam principle, generally called tattvam is principle. Principle is tattvam hitam purushartham. Tattvam hitaha purushartaha. So these three principles must be understood. And that is tattvam. Tattvatrayam we say. Tattvatrayam. In our Vaishnava Sampradaya, tattvatrayam is very famous. That means the true principle is the Lord, tattvam. The second is hitam, he is favorable. Then purushartham is a moksha, is a final purushartha, namely the human goal, which is called salvation, emancipation. So that is tattva. Then tattvena, with the knowledge of tattva, praveshtam, to enter. That is enter. The entering is our heart should be entered by him. Or our jivatma will enter into his heart. So praveshtam cha parantapa. Parantapa is an address to Arjuna. Parantapati iti parantapaha. Arjuna, on seeing Arjuna, every enemy is shivering. Rather, they become sick. As soon as the enemies see Arjuna, they become highly sick. They are afraid. They don't want to fight with Arjuna. And they know that he is a very good fighter. And once you fight with him, we understand we cannot escape from him. And therefore, param tapati. Tapati. He burns him. He burns the enemy. Tapati. He makes us hot. In the sense, hot by suffering. He makes the enemies suffer. Parantapa. It's only an address, what we call Sambodhana Prasavavakti, vocative case, and he addresses Arjuna. He addresses Arjuna to encourage him that he must be ready to fight immediately and so on. So he now gives the advice how to go about understanding him and seeing him. So we say, aham, bhaktya ananya eva shakya. Bhaktya to ananya shakya. Aham evam vidho Arjuna, evam vidaha Arjuna. In this way you have to know him, know me. Jnatum drashtam cha, jnatum drashtam cha. Then lastly he says, oh Arjuna, you must try.
So that is Bhagavad Gita, 11th chapter, 54th verse. Do you want to see the verse?
No, it is already there in full.
So,
unless the participants need an English translation by ISKCON, you can show them.
My dear Arjuna, only by undivided devotional service can I be understood as I am, standing before you, and can thus be seen directly. Only in this way can you enter into the mysteries of my understanding.
Okay. Now, I would rather subscribe to the translation of Rider of Panchatantra. If you have seen Rider's translation, R-Y-D-E-R. I think William Rider or somebody else. The Rider's translation of Panchatantra. He is so shrewd that he translates every word into English.
So he's this man writer's done a translation of Bhagavad Gita.
We don't know, but I want a similar translation. It is not my dear Arjuna. It is not my dear Arjuna. It is my dear Arjuna in bracket, but Parantapa, one who burns the enemies. So that should be the right translation. Because we must understand the adjective. We cannot just go on saying Arjuna, Arjuna, or the whole of the Bhagavad Gita. Various words are there. Partha. Partha is there.
Swami, I have one by Withrop Sargent, which is more literal translation. Mm-hmm. He explains Parantapa as scorcher of the foe.
Yeah, scorcher of the foe. Yeah, right. That should be the right translation. As you said, it's not a literal translation. I mean, it's a better translation than this is for only people, beginners. Oh dear Arjuna, my dear Arjuna is for beginners. Should we go deep into the word, adjective, so that we can understand. Scorcher of the foe is better. I just wanted to say, rider translates by Panchatantra as Mahila Nagaram. Mahila Nagaram, women's city, ladies' city, Mahila Nagaram. Then something like the Swarna Aropyam, we have the gold imposed city. He is translating every word, every part of the word. That will be better for people studying Sanskrit.
Right, so he translated Panchatantra, did he? But do you know if he translated Bhagavad Gita as well or not?
I don't know whether the writer has translated.
Okay, so I'll look for that and see what else he has translated, because he's a favorite of yours, so I will look for more translations by him.
And this is okay, the scorcher of the foe. So why just as we must get we must know that Arjuna is appreciated by Lord every now and then. He is encouraged to fight. Otherwise, he will desist from fighting. That's it.
I think
he must also achieve his end. Yeah. Krishna should achieve his end.
Yeah, I think also some of the different names of Arjuna are given in different contexts.
Yeah.
So Krishna calls him Gudakesha.
Yeah.
He calls him Parantapa, he calls him Partha, he calls him many different names, and in different contexts he calls. But also we have the other names, the literal names. Dhritarashtra means something. The word Dhritarashtra, it must mean something.
Yeah.
And also all these names also have an inner meaning.
Yeah. Dhritarashtra is, in spite of the share to be given to the cousins, his brother's son, he always holds the kingdom to himself. Dhritarashtram. Rashtram is the kingdom. Dhrita is, he selfishly holds it with him in himself. He confines the kingdom with himself, to himself. He doesn't want to share the kingdom.
Right. So sometimes people may see this meaning, and they may think, was the king's name actually Dhritarashtra, or is this just an adjectival explanation about him? You know. In other words, his name may be something else.
Even today, we do not know the original name of Kalidasa.
I see.
Kalidasa is a devotee of the slave of Parvati. That's all, God of Parvati. But we don't know the exact name. Neither we know the names of parents.
Some of the names of the Alvars are like this also. Bhaktangri Renu.
And that is because of they are Ayonijas. They are automatic, what you call Swayam Vyakta, Vyaktis. They came of their own. Tirupan Alvar was brought up by Dalit parents, Harijan parents. He was born, he appeared in paddy field in Orayu.
Yes, about
Payalwar
is a ghost.
Yeah,
like a ghost.
Poigi, Bhutam, Peyarvar, all of them came out of the tank.
Some other stories.
Kalidasa is a human being. As a human being. Whereas these are all Bhagavad Amshat, the part and parcel of the Lord.
So,
if you have any further...
So if anybody has any questions on this sloka and the first part of the commentary?
You can also come out with your own explanations, rather extending the explanation further.
Okay, so I guess I'm gonna just say some things then. First of all, I wanted to say that looks like there are a lot of synonyms here. Sometimes you ask us for synonyms. Mm-hmm. So in the commentary, this Shakshatkara Hetu Bhutam Avalokan, that is one synonym for Shakshatkara Avalokanam. And also Divyam Chakshuhu is also a synonym, and also this drastum, nyatum drastum.
So
I wanted to ask about that because as you said, gyanat mokshaha or gyanan mokshaha, you said correctly with the sandhi, gyanan mokshaha. That is ablative case, panchami vibhakti ekavachanam, that from jnana we get moksha. Does it mean until we die we never get knowledge? Because if we say only videha mukti is correct, and if we say that moksha occurs only from jnana, does it mean that we cannot have jnana in this life?
Yeah, that is only accepted by our sampradaya. Namely, I again remind ourselves that jnana yoga contains karma yoga. We cannot say both jnana yoga is divorced from the other three yogas, and then therefore jnanat moksha. From straight away from the wisdom, discipline of wisdom, you get moksha. Already jnanam, jnana yoga contains both, or three, all the three. Prapatti yoga is also there, plus bhakti and karma. That is different. Now, number one, which you are aiming at is, we cannot have jivan mukta here, because as soon as you get wisdom, you are out of this world.
So can we say as soon as you get full wisdom, as soon as you get full jnana, you're going to die and go to moksha. But until that time, we only have partial jnana. Mm. Is that correct?
Yeah, we will be limited.
It'll be limited. So still, even in this world, as long as we're in this world, we have some limitations on our jnana. We can't fully know. So if we can't fully know, how can we fully see? You said seeing the Shakshatkara Avalokana is the same as seeing him through understanding him. So Arjuna was able to see the Lord, and normally in the 11th chapter of the Gita, universal form of the Vishwarupa, we think that he actually saw with his own Mangsa Chakshu, his own eyes, he saw the Lord, the universal form. But you're equating Shakshatkara Avalokana with also understanding him through the shastras. So does it mean, how is it possible for him to fully understand the Lord while he was still living? So he was still living. Doesn't that mean when he saw the universal form, he's a Jivan Mukta?
I appreciate very, very intelligent question. Arjuna, Though living after the Bhagavad Gita, after the advice through the Bhagavad Gita, he understood Of course, he understood. He could see the Vishwarupa, the universal form of Lord. But again, he comes back to his old senses, that he is restless, he is not able to understand because of his Maya. The Maya deludes him again further. For a moment, he has seen this is only ordinary perception, though with the divine eyes. He has been granted the divine eye to look at the universal form. That was only momentary for Arjuna. In the case of Arjuna, it is only temporary. So again, he comes back to the ordinary human senses. He is not divine. His knowledge is not divine further. He understands him little, because he is a great friend. He has been granted the supra vision. He understands. He is able to see. Sakshatkara avalokanam, he is able to do that. He is able to know him, vidhi. But he did not reach him. Though he was nearby, he was very nearby. He was the driver of the chariot. He was the driver of the chariot. We say in English very, very beautifully, very near, but yet so far. We are very near, but see, again, the same thing happens in our case also. Our heart has got Antaryami, the Lord. Lord has Antaryami in our heart. We read books. We understand that He is Antaryami in our soul, in our Jivatma. But how much do we realize? How much do we, can I explain to you the divine experience? I cannot exchange my divine experience. Only thing is, I can give you examples of the blessings that I receive, but not the divine experience. Why he is not understandable? Though we read a lot of books, we go to acharyas and find out. One example I give from the often. From the Vishnu Sahasrama, look at the Vamana Avatara, he is a dwarf. Trivikrama Avatara, he is taller than the world. How do we reconcile two positions at the same time? Number one. So, Sahasrama says, Anuhu, he is in the form of atom. Then Brihat is as big as the 14 worlds. The creation plus Nitya Vibhuti, Lila Vibhuti and Nitya Vibhuti put together. Anur Brihat, he is lean, Krishaha, he is slim, Tholaha, he is big. How can at the same time one man be slim? Today I had a news that one actor of the film became so skinny.
That is possible only by dieting.
So by yoga, by hatha yoga, by physical exercise, some people reduce their body weight so quickly and suddenly and lose lot of weight, 10 kilos, 20 kilos and so on. You have seen them earlier obese, then later you see them slim, and then they become again obese. That is. So, whereas the Lord is always obeyed and always slim. Krishaha and Stulaha. Guna Bhrita Nirguno Maha. Of course, in Vaishnava Sampradaya, we explain the word Nirguna differently. Whereas Advaita says, he is with auspicious qualities and he is without qualities. That is Advaita explanation. Guna Bhrita is full of auspicious qualities in unlimited number. Then Nirguna Vide, he is without the bad qualities. So, Heya Guna Vihinaha. That's why unavoidable negative qualities are not there in him. So, this is the whole sentence in the Vishnu Sahasrama. Anuhu Brihat Krishaha Stulaha Guna Bhrita Nirguno Mahan is great. We are not able to understand the opposites in one person. Opposites in one person.
Right, but the Advaita understanding of that verse in Vishnusahstranam doesn't make sense, actually.
Yeah,
because he says they have auspicious qualities.
We have different philosophies. We have to accept them to ascend to our philosophy. The problem is our understanding.
No, the problem is their understanding.
Okay.
Not
I don't mean the word nirguna. I mean all the words.
Sure. Yes.
So you, for example, you and I. Take for example you and I. We are good to someone. We are wicked to someone. We are bad to someone. Some people mistake us. Some people treat us in a good manner. Some people treat us badly. We are not a thing to reckon with. For some people, we are not a thing to reckon with. I would put it rather in a blunt way. They think that we are blade of grass, a small blade of grass. No, why is this? Just for example, we are not respected by some people, but we are sometimes disrespected also. We are respected by some people. We have friends and enemies. Why? Are we good or are we bad? Are we good, both good and bad? Are we good in high percentage and bad in low percentage, or the other way about? Vice versa. That is why in the case of Lord, it is not possible to ascertain his nature. And therefore, Arjuna, I can say definitely, did not understand before his death.
So
we say this joke very clearly. After listening to Lord Krishna in the Bhagavad Gita, he never changed his mind. He never got himself corrected. He's still a bad student.
Well, up until the Charma Sloka, after the Charma Sloka, though, he did surrender to Krishna, and then he fought.
Yeah. No, surrendering is different. Getting the wisdom is different.
Right. So I understand your point that that moksha is everlasting. So.
Yeah.
So moksha is permanent and eternal. So once we reach moksha, we never come back from moksha. So if you're in a state of moksha or a state of full knowledge, you can never come back to a state of less knowledge. So because Arjuna showed that he momentarily he had knowledge of the Lord, he saw the Lord, but then again he became covered. So can we say that he had a momentary Jivan Mukti? Is it momentary Jivan Mukti? Because he saw the Lord in
form. He was not a released soul. Even when he saw the Lord universal form, he was not a released soul. He could not call him Mukta.
Okay, but he did see. He had a Shakshat Avalokana. He did have a momentary glance of the Lord. So sometimes the Lord might do this. He might give a momentary glance to the devotees, to the bhaktas, just to inspire them.
Right.
But it doesn't. It's not immediate moksha.
Yeah.
Okay. So some other things I had to ask about was you were saying avalokanam. Avalokanam means looking down.
Yeah.
So in the sense you were saying looking down at the heart. So can we infer that avalokanam actually means meditation? Because the heart is equated with the mind, with manas. So if we are looking at the heart or looking down, just like Krishna in the fourth chapter, he says we should look at the tip of the nose.
Yeah.
This is also Avalokanam, no?
Right.
So
your concept is very much acceptable.
Thank you. Okay, so Avalokanam means meditation. So the wisdom comes only through reading the books, but also meditating upon the meaning of the books, of the Shastras.
Yes, right, right.
Okay. So that's just...
And until you think of the meaning of the book later, after reading once, then only we will realize the inner meaning. I got some such revelations in literature. When I interpreted for the first time by reading the translation, mere translation, and literal meaning was given once. Second, while I read it again, same literature, same word, same context, same situation, I have different thoughts that I have experienced in many.
So this is why we can read the Gita again and again and again,
yeah.
And we can get more and more realization. And also, if we think about it, if we think about the class and think about the concepts in the commentary and in the Gita, we can get more and more out of it each time. Okay, so that's nice. Also,
and again, this Avalokanam, I told you just now, Lord looks at us. That is because of in association with you, interested people, I could get that meaning on my own. Avalokanam is not our seeing the Lord, but Lord seeing us. This kind of interpretation, I got it only through you, through you all. Maybe you are the main cause.
Swami, when you say grammar of the Lord, is it all his attribute? It's the total. Think of that grammar of the Lord. Meditate on the grammar of the Lord.
Right. Now, by grammar, you can deeply understand a word. Otherwise, the word, the example I gave was Mukunda. You take Achyuta, any word. Achyuta will give, he will not drop you down. That is Achyuta, naturally little mean. Take Govinda, there are different shades of mean. That is why Goda Devi said, so far I have been calling you with a big name, now I am calling you with a small name. Siruper Araitanavum Shiri Aruladhe. Because I am calling you with a nickname, don't get angry. Govinda is not a nickname. Govinda is not a small name. For your information, if you go into the deep meaning of Govinda, you will. I'll tell you just two or three immediately. Go meaning knowledge. Go meaning jnana. So he gets you the wisdom. Govinda. Go is cow, as you know already. Go is cow. So he takes care of the cows. He is a cowherd. Then go is Bhumi. He came to the earth as Lord Krishna. He came down as an incarnation. Incarnation is called Avataraha. Please understand the Sanskrit word so that you will understand the meaning of Govinda. Go meaning Bhumi. Go meaning being Bhumi because the earth is called a cow. Generally, earth is called a cow. In Kali Yuga, we say that the cow has only one leg. Whereas in Krita Yuga, it had four legs. In Treta Yuga, it had three legs. In Dwapara Yuga, it had two legs. And Kali Yuga, it had only one leg. Why is standing, the cow is standing with one leg, meaning that the Adharma is very rampant in Kali Yuga. Rampant in Kali Yuga. And therefore, the Dharma Denu, the holy cow, the righteous cow in the form of earth, is standing on one leg, suffering. And this go is Bhumi. Therefore, go vindati iti, ga vindati iti. He came to the earth. to protect us. Paritranaya sadhunam sambhavami, sambhavami. Yada yada hi dharmasya glanit bhavati bharata tadatmanam srijami aham. I create myself. So all these are because of Govinda. The word Govinda is very important. The Govinda, please note, I think you may remember, Govinda, the name was given by Kamadhenu to the Lord. Please understand from Bhagavatam, the word Govinda name was given to him by the divine cow, Kamadhenu, while he refused to, rather he made the cowherds offer the food to, he did not allow the cowherds to offer food to the food to Indra, the god of God, but to the mountain, Govardhana.
Yes. Govardhana. After the Govardhana Leela, then Indra and the Surabhi came, yeah, and they apologized
and Surabhi gave the name Govinda. Therefore, okay, just not to understand one, the word Govinda, we have got to look at the different meanings. Why I say this is, by reading all these meanings, we don't get the wisdom. We don't realize God. We can understand different meanings. Arjuna is like us, and we are like Arjuna.
Yeah. I had one other point that I wanted to ask about. In the verse itself, it says that bhakti is the only upaya.
Pardon?
Bhakti eva avalokana. Does it say? Bhakti eva.
Bhakti ananya.
So bhakti is the only. But normally when we look in Artha Panchika, we see that there are these five. Five upayas, you know, there's the Karma Yoga, Jnana Yoga, Bhakti Yoga, Prapati, and Acharya Abhimana as the five, yeah, according to the Artha Panchika scheme. So it's interesting here that it says only by bhakti. He can be known only by bhakti.
Yeah. As I said, bhakti involves all the yogas.
So bhakti includes all the others. Oh, sorry. I think you're muted.
In order to get bhakti, you start with karma yoga by doing prayers and do your service to God, and then it leads to jnana, and then leads to the others. Everything is interconnected.
That's what I was saying. While you do karma yoga, that is ordinary duties like starting with the getting up.
Yeah.
When you get up from the bed, you say the names of Lord Sri Hari ki 7 times, then you look at your right palm and say Karagre Vasate Rakshu, meaning go on remaining yourself the names of God, remembering Him, His blessings, that you are very safe in spite of the world problem. Then again you light up the lamp. Subham Karoti Kalyanam Arogyam Dhana Sampada Shatru Buddhi Vinashaya Deepa Jyotir Namostute. He says this. Every jewelry shop owner says this when he transfers the jewel to you, gives the jewel to you. And the one joke is there. He empties your purse and gives an empty purse as a gift. That is it. So the jewelry owner. So what he says this was in Shirang, in Trichy, Gopal Das Jewelry, or any other jewelry shop, they know they are Sindhis, they talk Hindi and so on. They say this was Subham Karoti Kalyanam. Then we say the Chatushloki last verse, rather sorry, it is from Gunaratna Kosha of Parasara Bhatta. Ullas Pallavita Palita Saptaloki Nirvaha Korakita Name Katakshali Lam Shiranga Hermitala Mangala Deepa Rekham. Mangala Deepa Rekham. That is where you start lighting the lamp. Mangala Deepa Rekham Sri Rangaraja Magishim Shiyamashrayamaha. Now, so to go on reciting, so somebody said, I was a little afraid. When you start cooking, you say, Adakkala Patu of Sri Vedanta Deshita. Unless you memorized it, you cannot do it. And if you cannot do it with a book and cook also at the same time. Cooking must be done by reciting Adakkala Patu of the Tamil Divya Prabandham of Sri Vedanta Deshita. Now, go on. Mukundamala, my grandmother used to recite Mukundamala by rote memory while she was cooking. That's why I got it also memorized. Every time you remember him, that is what Karma Yoga. In Karma Yoga, you realize that you have to understand him differently. You gain wisdom slowly. Then your bhakti is developed. All these three are together. And as you now realize, the grammar of the word is also important to understand why this name is given to the Lord. And if you read Bhagavad Guna Darpanam, namely Parashara Bhaktar's meanings of the Sahasranamam, plus Shankaracharya's, Adi Shankaracharya's Vishnu Sahasranama Bhashyam, then Madhva Bhashyam, Madhvacharya's Bhashyam, Vishnu Sahasranama. Ramanuja's Bhashya is not available on Vishnu Sahasranama. So Parashara Bhatta's Bhashyam is available. Then you compare and contrast and give, get the meanings of this thousand names, then we will have more understanding. But as Keshavdas Swami expects, we will not realize the God before death.
Okay, but I would very much like to have a class of Vishnu Sahasranama and understanding the meanings of each name according to the different acharyas. That would be very nice. And even, you know, the Gaudiya acharyas have also written a commentary on Vishnu Sahasranama. I think all the acharyas of different sampradayas have made Sahasranama Bhashya. So, very nice. One other thing in the, as we were talking about grammar, in the commentary here, the word tatvena is used, which is singular. Tritiya vibhakti, ekavachanam, tatvena.
Tatvena, yeah.
Yeah, but that tatvena, that truth, that principle is actually containing many principles.
This is a habit of Sanskrit words usage. Take for example, I will give you an example from Vedanta Deshika's Paduka Sahasram. Generally, the 2 feet are the 2 sandals are described. The 2 sandals are described. When I say Lord's foot in singular, it means 2 feet. At the same time, when you say 1 sandal, paduka, when I say paduka, it means paduke. It means 2 sandals. You can't have just like that. Kara, kara means hand, hasta means hand. When you say kara or hasta of the Lord, then it doesn't mean 4 hands. Because he has always got 4 hands. Chaturbhujaha. And ashtabhujaha in Kanchipuram, 8 hands. And so on. So normal as we have imagination of our own physical limbs, then in the whole of Paduka Sahasranam, he has either used in singular or dual. The singular word also denotes the dual.
And can the dual, can it the dual, the can the dual denote more than 2? Can Dvivachanam denote Bahuvachanam?
In pairs, it can have pairs.
Okay, so if I say in Dvaya Mantram, if I say Charanau, Charanam Prapadye, it can mean the feet of Lakshmi and Narayana.
Right, good.
Is it possible?
Right. It's
because this was a question I used to ask to the Vadagalais. That if you are if in Dvaya Mantram you are surrendering you are doing Sharanagati, Sharanam Prapadye, two feet of only Narayana.
Right.
So Lakshmi is not, her feet are not there. If it is Charana, it's only 2 feet.
The reason that her feet are not there, because she is in the chest of the Lord. She is sitting on the chest of the Lord.
Yeah, even if she sits on the knee of the Lord, his feet are lower.
Right.
She's higher. She's always higher.
It is understood that the charano can mean 4 feet.
Very good.
It is acceptable because you think of her along with him. That is most important.
So I read somewhere that that when washing the feet, some people think you should only offer water for, you should only wash the right foot, and other people are saying you have to wash both feet.
You have to wash both feet.
Yeah, you have to wash both feet.
In while you invite a guest inside your home, we have to do it for a Bhagavata. Then number two, in Shraddha ceremony, the annual anniversary, death anniversary, we do definitely both feet of the three people or if not two people, minimum. It is called Pada Prakshalanam.
Right, Pada Prakshalanam.
And we have what Brahmins, Shripada Tirtham.
Shripada Tirtham of the Acharya, of course.
Especially, but here the people who come to your house on the death anniversary day.
So the Brahmins that are there who are taking the food in as representing Vishnu and the Ashwini Kumaras and
Vishnu, Vaishvadevas and Pitris.
Vaishvadevas and Pitris, yes. So three Brahmins have to come and take food, and you have to wash their feet.
Yeah.
And you have to take the Sripada Tirtha also and sip it.
Yeah, of course, right thumb, right foot thumb.
From the right toe.
Right toe, yeah.
Yeah, the right big toe. So that you have to wash the right big toe only.
Yeah.
What about the other toes?
That is because Ganga came out of the right toe of the Lord.
I see. Ganga came out of the right toe. So when Trivikrama Avatara, when he pierced the covering of the universe, he did it with his right foot.
Right.
With his right foot.
Right.
So does it mean that he put his left foot on the head of Bali Raja? Bali Maharaja.
Yeah, I'm a Mahabali.
Did he put his left foot there?
Left, placing the left foot on the head is like disrespecting.
The left foot is disrespecting.
Yeah.
Okay, so I'm trying to understand Trivikrama Avatara. How many feet does he have? Because Trini Pada Vishnu Vichakrame, he has taken three steps.
Only with the 2 feet.
He has 2 feet. So then the right foot has pierced the covering of the universe.
Yeah.
And then
the right foot covered the seven walls.
Okay.
Not exactly right foot. He treaded all the walls, all the 14 walls. Seven walls by one step and another seven walls by another step. Second step. He could not find the third step.
Right. Okay, but normally we think, I don't know, normally people, they should normally start with the right foot and then the left foot. So two steps will be right foot, left foot.
I know.
Not like that?
No, not that. It's only a symbolic measurement.
I see. But when we go to Kanchipuram, there's a Ulagananda Perumal.
Yeah.
Yeah. And that Ulagananda Perumal in Kanchipuram, he has 1 foot very high in the air.
Yeah.
That has to be his right foot.
Yeah.
That has to be his right foot, because you're saying the right toe is the one
right.
where the Ganga came, which was the Karnataka ocean. The Viraja River is flowing through out from there. And the other underneath his other foot, in Ulagananda Perumal, underneath his other foot is the head of Mahabali being pushed into the earth.
Right.
So in that temple, that means the left foot is on his head.
If it is the vigraha is like that, you can accept it.
But normally in the leela of Sri Vikrama avatar, we understand that the Sri Vikrama put his right foot on the head of Bali. He should have put the right foot on. Is it?
But the figure of the right foot going up in the air, going up above, it shows the left and right foot covered all the 14 worlds.
Yes.
The left foot, the Patala Loka, up to the Patala Loka, and the right foot up to the top lower world.
Right.
That is only the.
I was just trying to understand which foot the Sri Vikrama avatar put on the head of Bali. That's all. if it's not mentioned, it doesn't matter. But just because you said that the Ganga comes from the right toe, and also that putting the left foot is disrespectful. Yeah, I think putting the right foot also is a little bit disrespectful. But if we're going to put any foot on somebody, we should put the right foot, which is a little bit more respectful.
And no. while we get off the bed,
normally when we enter somebody's new house, when you enter a house we put a right foot inside.
And in Pancharatra, when you enter into the Garbhagriha, you have to enter in with the right foot.
Yeah.
Right.
And many times I've seen people going even into the temple when they cross the threshold of the temple.
Right.
When I go to Ranganayaki Sannidhi in Sri Rangam, I always make sure that I enter with the right foot first. I don't want to enter with the wrong foot with Mahalakshmi. So I always enter with the right foot.
But many people don't do it because they don't know. They put their left foot.
I think, some people don't enter the temple at all. So entering the temple is a good thing, no matter how you do it. But if you want to do it correctly, you should try to do it with the right foot first. In English, we have a saying. We say, put your best foot forward. Somebody will encourage another person. You put your best foot forward. You do your best. So the best foot is the right foot. Maybe for ladies, the best foot is the left foot. I don't know.
The left foot is supposed to be better, isn't it?
The left foot is better for ladies. I don't know.
If the left side for ladies is considered more auspicious than the right side for men, well, then the women should enter with their left foot, isn't it? My wife said that's speculation.
Yeah, and when we get off the bed, we have to keep our left leg on the floor and then ask for pardon.
We have to put our left leg first?
Yeah.
Okay.
Parvata sthanamandite Vishnu Patni Namastubhyam.
Yes, I know the prayer.
Padaspasam is Vama Padaspasam. It is not mentioned there, but we have to put out the left leg.
Okay, so this is very complicated because Dr. Alwar was telling us that when you sleep, you have to sleep on your left side.
Yeah.
But then you have to turn over onto your right side.
Yeah.
But then when you get up, you have to turn, you have to get up.
Again to the left.
Again, you have to come to the left.
Yeah.
And then you have to get up. And you're saying first you have to put the left foot.
Yeah.
And then you have to pray.
Yeah.
Right foot down.
Yeah.
Before you put your foot on the ground, on the floor, you have to pray and do it. Because after kicking, you should not, don't ask for excuse. First ask for excuse and then.
Then kick. Okay. So first. So before you put, but the first foot you put is the left foot.
Yeah.
I see. I'll have to look in the Anikam. Yeah, we'll have to check in the Anikam. What is this actual system?
No, I'm sure. And just because, just to say yes to Govindacharya Swami, because for the ladies, the left foot is important. Because Bhuma Devi is a lady, we put the left foot on her.
Okay.
I see.
Okay, so it's some more things to investigate and to realize and to meditate upon, and we'll understand. Right. Maybe we don't understand fully right now. At least I'm talking for myself only. But
whether right now or right later, we will not realize.
I'm confused too.
Until we become released soul.
Yes, maybe I can only understand this in moksha. I don't know. Possibly. Okay, so.
And again, I of course, repeat. Bahunam janmanam ante jnanavan maam prapadde.
Yes, Vasudeva Samamiti. That's all. Samahatma Sudulabaha. Sudulabaha. So we have some Sudulabaha, some very rare people. They can understand all these things. So I will meditate upon all these things and try to realize them. Maybe I will become also Sudulabaha.
Swami, one last. I liked your Bhagavad Dhyana Sopana Sabhipraya. No matter, you said it very nicely. So we wish we can get that going more of that, those things.
I actually memorized the musical form from Dr. Manikrishna Swami.
Oh, I see.
Ragamani.
I was talking about the Sabhipraya, which Swami explained. Yes. Right.
That's why I said Lord's Avalokanam is more relevant than our Avalokanam.
Yeah, it's very, very beautiful.
Right, but we enjoyed the musical recitation today from you, and we were understanding by hearing that musical edition was helping us to understand.
Yeah.
Very nice.
कवितार्किक सिंहाय कल्याण गुणशालिने श्रीमते वेंकटेशाय वेदांत गुरवे नमः.